So good morning. I will show you some studies we performed about high-risk low IOLs in complex cataract cases. We conducted a retrospective study of retropupillary high-risk low IOLs implantation in 320 eyes of 320 patients, collecting data from January 2002 to December 2009. And we published this paper on BMC ophthalmology 2 years ago. We divided the cases in three groups. Group one, post-traumatic subluxation or total dislocation of crystalline lens and ruptured cataract lenses without adequate capsular support, with or without severe laceration of iris that required reconstruction. In this video, you can see a sample. It was a very hard cataract and very luxated capsular support. So actually, there was no more capsular support. So we had to convert the technique. We started with phaco, but we had to convert technique to intracapsular cataract extraction in order to avoid the pieces of the nucleus falling down in the vitreous chamber. So we had to open the corneal wound and we tried to remove all the pieces of the cataract of the nucleus outside of the anterior chamber. And you can see step by step we tried to avoid the nucleus falling down in the vitreous chamber, and we managed to extract this big dense cataract. So now, of course, anterior vitrectomy with the transenolone to stay in the vitreous. You can see anterior chamber infusion, and now the iris claw implantation on the posterior surface of the iris. So in this case, we preferred the retropupillary implantation of the iris claw. You can see with the dominant hand, we are holding the lens, and with the other hand, we are doing the enclavation with the spatula. So we are focusing on centration of the lens, and you can see the enclavation is done. The IOL is centered and the anterior chamber is good. Another case, again a trauma. This was a bottle cork trauma. So you can see vitreous hemorrhage. The trauma caused the complete luxation of the crystalline lens in the vitreous chamber. So you can see the lens is down on the posterior pole, and you can see also iridodialysis. So the iris was lacerated with dialysis, but the good point was that the retina was not detached. It was strange because usually in this severe trauma you usually find the retinal detachment, but not in this case. But you can see a big retinal break. There was this very big retinal break, almost for 180 degrees, but still the retina was attached. So we did the endolaser, of course. So we did the sealing of the break with laser. And now we are completing the peripheral vitrectomy, again laser. You see a lot of laser because the break was very long, was almost 180 degrees. And we are completing the peripheral vitrectomy with the shaving of the vitreous base. You can see. And now we are focusing on the crystalline lens. The lens was quite soft because the patient was quite young, so we could eat the lens with vitrectomy probe. The vitrectomy, in this case, we were using 23 gauge. So with this 23 gauge vitrectomy, we could eat all the lens. We didn't need the phaco, we just used the vitrectomy machine. And so the lens was completely removed. We just finishing the endolaser for 360. And now we are focusing on the iris. You can see the iris was very in a traumatic mydriasis. We are removing the blood clots from the angle. Of course, the angle has to be clean. And now again, iris claw implantation with the retropupillary enclavation. So even in these cases, even when you have a traumatized iris, you can do iris claw enclavation, because you just need 2 points of good iris to do the enclavation. Now we repositioned the superior part of the iris where you saw the iridodialysis, and now in the inferior part, using the Sipser technique, I am doing the iridoplasty. So with this Sipser technique, it's very good to do iridoplasty and pupilloplasty to obtain a better pupil, send a round pupil and a smaller pupil, because this patient, you can see, this patient had a very wide mydriasis. So this is the Sipser technique with the Prolin 10-0. And now with this technique, you can see the pupil is narrower, is smaller, and good centered. So this was the final result. We are okay, this is the final endotamponade with gas. So we put gas for the final tamponade, and this is the final result. The iris claw is well enclavated. The pupil is quite round, and the anterior chamber is stable. So this was a good result. So the second group of the study was another type of patients with the post-cataract surgery aphakia that resulted from intra or post-operative complications. Cases with subluxation or total dislocation of the IUL. For example, in this case, in the video, you see this was a subluxated IUL. So we had to remove the IUL. And again, iris claw on the posterior surface of the iris. You can see the iris was very good, was not a trauma, so the iris was perfect, and the enclavation was very easy. The pupil is very round, very good shape. We completed the corneal suture. Now we are doing vitrectomy because the patient also had macular edema and macular pucker as a consequence of the subluxation of the IUL. So this is the posterior vitreo detachment, of course, the usual steps of the vitrectomy. So we just clean the peripheral shaving with the indentation with the light. This was a light indentation. And now the final adjustments, you can see with the forceps, we can adjust the pupil just to obtain a better pupil, a rounder pupil. So this is the final result. Again, it was a good situation with the round pupil, and the IUL was very well enclavated. The third group was cases in which keratoplasty was performed in association with vitrectomy. So very severe trauma. This is a pole-to-pole surgery. So in these cases, of course, you have damages in all structures of the eye, from the cornea to the lens to the retina. So you can see now open sky approach. In open sky, we are doing anterior vitrectomy. You can see this huge iridodialysis. We are removing the capsular bag because it's not useful anymore. And we are doing iridoplasty to attach the iris to the angle. You can see the iris was very highly detached. So now with the iris suturing, we are completing the iridoplasty. We position the Eckert temporary keratoprosthesis, and now we are doing vitrectomy. Again, shaving on the vitreous base, staining to do the island peeling to prevent secondary macular pucker formation, because in these cases, you want to avoid the secondary macular pucker formation. Again, iridoplasty just to complete the pupil, and open sky, this is open sky approach, implantation of the iris claw in the posterior surface of the iris. So this is another way, open sky with the posterior enclavation of the iris claw. And then the final graft. This is the final corneal graft to complete the surgery. Okay, this was finished. Another case, again, corneal trephination, open sky again, iris suturing to obtain a better pupil, and then iris claw implantation in open sky. With open sky, it's even faster, it's even easier. And after iris claw implantation, again, the final corneal graft position. So this is again a suturing of the iris to obtain a better pupil. And this is the final steps, so you can see a good result. I will go on. So, results. This was a big study, so you can see a lot of eyes. And the mean follow-up was 5.3 years. So, results. The mean postoperative visual acuity was better in all three groups. And very important, the postoperative residual spherical equivalent error was not a lot. Was 1.5 to diopter, so the calculation was good. In all cases, the IOLs were stable, except for three cases that presented subluxation because of slippage of one of the iris claw optics. And these three IOLs were refixated in all three cases. Only one case of complete spontaneous dislocation. I remind you, it was 320 eyes, so a lot of eyes, no complication. Only one case developed retinal detachment. No cases of uveitis. 8 cases complained a chronic dull eye pain, no problem. 3 cases complained blurred vision. 5 cases showed severe iridodonesis. Only 3 cases showed cystoid macular edema, which developed 2 months after implantation. Oval pupil was seen in 5% of cases in association with iridoplasty, of course, and pigment dispersion was detected in 3 eyes in group 1. Mean postoperative IOP was 16, so very good IOP. Only few cases had the postoperative increased IOP, which was managed medically only with topical anti-glaucoma drugs. So no problems for IOP. And also the preoperative endothelial cell density and the postoperative values of endothelial cell density was not statistically significant. So no endothelial cells loss. Conclusion, complication related to retropupillary iris claw implantation were minimal compared with its benefits. Using retropupillary implantation of the iris claw lens for secondary implantation is a valid alternative strategy to classic scleral fix or angle support IOL implantation. I just say very few things about another study that is impressed. We made a big comparison between anterior chamber iris claw versus posterior chamber iris claw. And I will skip introduction, of course. And we found that actually with 59 patients, 27 patients group anterior, 32 posterior. And we found that actually no statistically significant differences between anterior and posterior. We prefer the retropupillary implantation because of aesthetic results, because iris claw in the posterior chamber is more physiological position, and because there are no other reason to choose anterior or posterior. You can see the visual acuity was good in both groups, and also the spherical equivalent was good, the cylinder astigmatism was not significant, Suture removal, of course, improved the astigmatism after 1 month. And again, endothelial cell loss was not important, IOP not significant. Macular edema was not significant because both groups showed very few cases of macular edema. So, conclusion, only a few cases of Irving gas, 6 cases in 59 patients. So, in conclusion, both groups were good. So, we prefer the retropapillary, but anterior and posterior are very good solutions. Thank you very much.